Podcast Center. We are going to continue our conversation today. So when it comes to getting rid of plastics, Rhode Island is a bit ahead of the curve, so I'm told. Rhode Island does not incinerate plastics, but our surrounding neighbors do, Connecticut and Massachusetts. They still burn plastics. So to talk a little bit about how we get rid of our plastics and to talk about source reduction in general, I'd like to introduce Jonathan Berard. He's from Clean Water Action Rhode Island. There's an event coming up on Monday. So to find out how you can get involved if you're interested and to talk about what we need to do to protect our future, I'd like to introduce Jonathan. I believe he's here. There he is. John, how are you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good. So good to see you.
Absolutely.
Thanks for coming in on this lovely day. It wasn't too bad earlier, but
I got a little wet, but it's all right.
All right. So on Monday, there's a few different agencies that are partnering to make a stand outside of the American Chemistry Council Marine Debris Solution Conference in Newport. I had to look at my notes to make sure I had all that right.
It's a mouthful.
So Clean Water Action of Rhode Island is one of those agencies and participating in this organization outside of this conference. Why don't you tell me a little bit about what this conference is and then what your agency and other agencies are doing?
Sure. So this conference is, like you said, put together by the American Chemistry Council. They're plastics manufacturers from all across the world, many here in the United States, but globally.
Okay.
And they've convened a bunch of stakeholders in Newport, Rhode Island to discuss what to do about the problem of plastic pollution and marine debris, specifically marine debris that we find, you know, floating in the middle of our oceans, and that wash up on beaches and shores all across the world. And so they've invited a lot of people to be there. I'll be there just to hear what they have to say. But their solution for taking care of plastic pollution is to figure out ways to get rid of it after we've used it.
Okay.
And so all of the folks who are going to be speaking at this conference are really going to be talking about what we call end of pipe solutions. So that is ways that we manage our waste, specifically plastic, once it has been sold, used by us, and then enters into either our waste stream or our environment.
And that's the majority. Those are the people that are speaking at the conference.
Yeah, pretty much.
Really?
Yeah. Okay. So you know, Clean Water Action and several of the partner organizations that you mentioned that we're going to be working with, you know, that is not our philosophy. And so we believe in a theory of change around this topic that involves, like you said, source reduction. And so instead of, you know, figuring out what to do with these plastic things that we use once we've used them, we advocate for what we call source reduction, which means just making less of it and selling less of it and using less of it. And that's really the way that we're going, that's the only way we're going to be able to solve our problem is by using less of this stuff.
Okay. So you are going there, and what's happening? What are the agencies doing on Monday at this conference or outside of the conference?
Sure. So so Monday morning at 8 o'clock, so the conference starts at 9, so between 8 and 9, we'll be outside across the street from the Hotel Viking in Newport where the conference is taking place. And we're not, you know, demonstrating, we're not picketing or anything like that, but we are demanding that source reduction be considered as a way to reduce plastic pollution. We are trying to bring our voices to the table. And so we are demanding of conference goers that we talk about source reduction as well as these end of pipe solutions. And you know, we're always gonna have these things that we have to deal with at the end of their lives. But there's we can do things to ensure there's actually less of it.
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit about these because I found it interesting that you know, when you think about getting rid of stuff, the end of pipe, so we'll get to the source reduction in a moment. But in reality, people are using plastics, people are using stuff, so we do have to figure out what to do to get rid of it, and that's what this group is going to be doing. In Rhode Island, you've told me, someone else has told me that Rhode Island, we don't burn plastics, we don't incinerate plastics. And you told me that people next door do.
Yeah.
They're still doing that. Let's talk about why incinerating isn't a good option.
Wow, where do we start? So incineration is typically the way that we kind of handled our municipal waste, you know, last century. And so a lot of that waste was paper goods and food items and things like that. And so we burned it, and it wasn't the best solution, but it wasn't like a terrible thing. With the advent of plastics and synthetic materials, we kept burning it, and places still do.
I'm gonna just take a time out real quick. I feel like we all know, like when we're out at a campfire, that you don't throw plastic on the campfire, right? Because it's not good for you to breathe in. So just I feel like that's all, right?
Yeah.
Don't you learn that when you're a little kid? Don't throw that on. So I just wanted to put that out.
Yeah. No, right? Don't throw. It's the exact same concept, right? You throw a plastic thing on a fire and it burns this weird color, and then it's this, you know, you smell the smoke and it's like really bad, because what you're really doing is burning fossil fuels. Plastic is made of oil and other fossil fuels, so when you burn a plastic item, you're creating, you're creating carbon emissions, and you're burning all of the other gnarly stuff that's in plastic. And so there's all sorts of toxics and heavy metals that are released from plastics when we incinerate them. And so so it's generally a bad idea. So we've had an incineration ban here in Rhode Island for a long time. And you're right. Our neighbors do incinerate a lot of their waste, and here in Rhode Island, like I said, we don't burn it right now. But our landfill is coming close to the end of its life. Rhode Island Resource Recovery has estimated that our landfill has till about 2033. So it's about 15 years. In solid waste terms, that's like a blink. So we have about 15 years left. Of capacity in our landfill. And so now Rhode Island Resource Recovery and the state are looking at ways to extend the life of that landfill. What are we going to do? And they're actively considering what we call gasification. So this is a type of incineration as a long-term solution for their problem. They're not looking into ways to reduce the amount of waste. They're looking at new ways to deal with it once it arrives at their doorstep. And so, we're lucky that we haven't had it, and, our communities have been a little bit healthier, even though we probably get some of that air pollution from our neighbors, because we're very small and surrounded.
And it's air.
And it is air. air does not know political boundaries, as we know. But it's something to, keep our eye on, as the landfill gets fuller and fuller of stuff, there are going to have to be some novel solutions. And, the state is actively considering incineration gasification as a possible solution, and we do not want that at all. And so we want to work to reduce the amount of things that go to the central landfill, so it does extend the life, and so we don't have to revert to burning our garbage.
No kidding. Just the term gasification, I don't like the way that sounds.
Yeah, it's not great.
I don't like the way that sounds. So when we're going to, so this conference is on Monday, and they're looking at you and the other groups that are involved. So some of the agencies: Global Alliance for Incinerator Alternatives, Clean Water Action Rhode Island, Greenpeace International, and the Surfrider Foundation Rhode Island chapter are going to be there. So we're looking at source reduction. You want that to be on the table. If it doesn't get introduced, then what do we look at? How powerful are these people when it comes to plastic initiatives?
They're powerful. I mean, they have the money. We don't have the money. So they're the outliers.
Yeah.
So most organizations, NGOs, governments know that they need to reduce the amount of stuff that is generated, because it's expensive to take care of, right? It's expensive. So who takes care of, plastic and other items when, after they're made and enter the waste stream? Towns and cities do, and that's passed down to us as taxpayers, right? We pay for that stuff. We pay to get rid of all of this stuff. People think it's free, but it's not. It's built into our taxes, right? That's the majority. The majority want to see less things. They want to see fewer, items, especially hazardous items and difficult to dispose of items, many of which are made of plastic. They want to see fewer of that stuff because it's a nightmare for them. It's a nightmare for their budgets.
Yeah.
It's not anything that they have the power to deal with, though. All the power rests with the industry. And they don't really want to talk about source reduction because that impacts their bottom line.
Yeah, okay.
They put the stuff out into our economy, and once it gets past the point of profit, what we call the point of profit, where it either gets sold or distributed, they kind of wash their hands of it, and now it's all of our problems. And so they're thinking, they want to talk about novel ways to take care of this stuff once it's past that point of profit. Once it's in our recycling bins and our trash cans and in trash trucks or floating in the ocean, they're funding, these fun little ocean sweepers and things like that. But, that's really not going to solve our problem.
Want to stop it from getting there in the first place.
That's just a Band-Aid. Yeah, exactly. If you have a big cut, putting a Band-Aid on it might stop it for, stop the bleeding for a little bit, but you're going to eventually want to go see a doctor and get it sewn up. It's the same approach. We need to have the same approach to waste management. We really need to get at the problem and not the symptom.
So how do we get through to either the corporations or a council like this, or to our politicians? You know, Rhode Island has done a pretty decent job with cities and towns on the plastic bag bans, mm-hmm. on stuff like that. How do we get through? How do we, if people want to make a change, how do we get through?
Right. Since we don't have the money, we need to have the voice. And so that's the whole idea behind our action on Monday, is that, you know, we want to say that, you know, there are other voices, and these voices demand to be heard. And, you know, we can do the same thing for our local politicians. We can speak with our wallets, right? That's always something that we can do. You know, last time I was on here, we talked about things that I don't buy or don't use. And we can do that. As consumers, we can demand that, you know, the places that we shop, are the restaurants, our favorite restaurants that we go to, or, you know, our local supermarkets not have plastic bags, or use, you know, compostable products or washable dishes instead of, you know, foam plates. So we can as consumers demand that of our favorite places that we shop and eat and all of that. You know, we can also band together and demand of our elected officials that they pass these types of things. So we've seen leadership just this past year from the city of Newport and the town of Middletown, both of which have passed plastic bag bans. There are other communities in Rhode Island that are looking at this. You know, and you know, once we get more and more, hopefully maybe we'll see a statewide ban. And so, you know, Clean Water Action works on these things, and you know, we get our power, our political power, from our membership. We have just about 25,000 members here in Rhode Island, and so, you know, we can say that that's a big chunk of Rhode Island. You know, a small population, so that's a lot of people. And you know, if we put all of our voices together and demand that you know, our elected leaders, you know, pass laws that incentivize or require source reduction, then that's how we'll get stuff done. We don't have the money, but we have the voice, and I think that's really what we need to do.
And, I mean, I don't think it should be a political thing when it comes to breathing in clean air, right?
You would think that. but you're right. I mean, it's a no-brainer, you know, as far as I'm concerned. And, you know, what's funny is, you know, we were...
People make things political, though. I mean, I guess that's
everything's
just
political. it all has to do with, you know, budgets and yeah. You know, all of this stuff. And so, you know, but... That's the way that, you know, that's one lever that we have. You know, we don't have money, but we have the lever of, you know, of protections. These are protections, really, for our health, for our environment. So government can mandate that things happen and things change. We did it when we, you know, got lead out of gasoline and lead out of paint. And we did it when we, you know, stopped spraying certain pesticides that were causing, you know, harmful public health, you know, problems. And so this is just another thing that, you know, government has the power to help to solve.
What I think is interesting about this, too, is that oftentimes when it comes to making choices for healthy reasons, or, you know, buying organic can be very expensive, right? Yeah. So making choices for environmental reasons or for health reasons can be very expensive. But when it comes to stuff like this, for source reduction, if you are a consumer making a choice, it's not expensive. A lot of times you're just giving something up, right?
Yeah.
So you're just choosing not to use the plastic straw. You're choosing to bring your own cloth bag that's over and over again.
Yep.
Right? You're just choosing to use reusable ware.
Yep.
So it's often not expensive. So, yeah. And if we continue to use, you mentioned it could be more expensive in the long run if we keep having more plastics because our taxes will go up.
It absolutely is. It's absolutely more expensive because people are like, oh, I get my, you know, my plastic bag for free, and I get, you know, my water bottle for free, and all this stuff is free. It's really not. I mean, you pay, plastic bags are built into the cost of the food that you buy or whatever you buy, you know, and then, you know, you pay your taxes to dispose of it. Like a single-use bottled water, that's so expensive. Like, per gallon, that's like a ridiculous amount of money. I don't understand why people buy it. It's literally just tap water in a plastic bottle. You're much better off buying, you know, like a reusable bottle like that and just filling with tap water. It's exactly what you're buying when you buy, you know, an Aquafina or whatever. You know, that's tap water, and it's so much more expensive. And so you're actually paying a lot more for this stuff. And we're paying, you know, not only economically, but, you know, we're paying, you know, it's a public health issue.
Yeah,
you know, it's, you know, our environment has value. So, you know, we're losing value in our environment and our natural resources, especially here in Rhode Island. You know, our Narragansett Bay is like our crown jewel. It's our thing. It's the driver of our economy.
Yeah.
And it's filling with plastic. It's literally filling with plastic on our beaches, in our waters. It's getting into seafood and things like that. And so, you know, that's a problem. We're gonna suffer economically because of this.
All right. So thinking to the future.
Yeah.
John Berard with Clean Water Action. Thank you so much. Yeah.